Well, thanks everybody. Oops, sorry.
No, you're good.
Thank you, Kevin. Thanks for coming out to 1 Million Cups. We'll get started with some introductions here. First off, we just want to say we're thankful for our sponsors. We have the library donated by the Madison Central Library. So if you see Tom out there, definitely give him a hello and thank you. They've been a good partner for us. We also have Field 59, and they have some pretty exciting news. They just signed a really big deal. Derek, do you want to give a couple words about that?
Sure, yeah. Just tooting our own horn here, but it's very excited that we just signed a deal with Community Newspaper Holdings Group, and it's 130 newspapers. We're rolling out 20 in February, but we'll continue to roll out more over the year, but it's a really big stepping stone for Field 59. We're really happy to work with them, and they got really great ideas, so we're excited to look at the next quarter or two, and yeah. So.
Awesome, well, congratulations. And Field 59 has been with us from the beginning. They provide the live stream and the video recording of every event, so if you ever miss 1 Million Cups or can't make it, click on the live feed link on our website or in our newsletter, and you can tune in, or you can go to our YouTube channel and catch any of those past presentations. And then we also have our coffee today, and that's courtesy of Old National Bank. They are our 6-month sponsor, and they make sure that we have hot, fresh, delicious coffee from Crescendo. So we're a pretty casual group here. During the presentation, feel free to fill your cup up until the pots are empty. And then what we're gonna do real quick is go around and do introductions before we turn it over to you, Kevin. So I'm...
Where the donuts come from?
Oh, the donuts, thanks to Kevin. He's the star today. Everyone got a little sugar rush, I hope, and I think caffeine and sugar makes the ultimate combo for your Wednesday morning and kind of pushes you through the rest of the week. So thank you for bringing in some treats today.
You're very welcome.
And eat up so he doesn't have to take a ton home with him.
Yes.
Hi, Danny. Hi, Matt. So we're going to go around the room and do introductions. So if you can just say who you are and who you're with or what you do, that would be great. It gives us an idea of who's in the room, and hopefully you can identify some people you might want to chat with. So I'm Rachel Neal. I am the CEO of Carrick's Consulting Group, and I'm an organizer at 1 Million Cups. And before I go to you, Drew Corson's usually here. He is in Hawaii right now, so you guys can all hate on him a little bit.
That's too bad.
And he's the chief strategy officer at Carex now.
You just started at your company. You gave him a vacation.
I know. I think I need the world's best boss mug.
All right, that's impressive.
Rachel, he's still at the law firm though?
No. No, he's he moved over to Carex.
Really?
Yeah.
Awesome. Hi everybody, I'm Lee Lazar. I'm an insurance agent with Associated Agencies, one-stop shop for insurance, business insurance, group benefits, personal.
Hello, I'm Zach Blumenfeld. I work for Task here in town, and then I also have a startup called Third Space that deals with company culture and employee engagement.
I'm Eric Brown. I'm a management consultant. I work a lot with early stage companies, growing companies.
Kurt Peterson, co-founder of 32 Auctions, a platform for hosting and managing silent auction fundraisers.
Steve Clod, co-founder of 32 Auctions.
Joey Frain, Wisconsin Economic Development Corporation. I work in the Division of Entrepreneurship and Innovation, so we have a couple direct assistance programs that assist startups.
My name's Diana Pastrana. I am with M&M Office Interiors, so we do anything from the chair you're sitting on to whole new space kind of a deal. My first time, so thanks guys.
And I'm Jen Plogel. I'm a business operations executive. I'm actually currently looking for a new opportunity.
Molly Siegel, I'm with Talavant. We presented last week, but if you weren't here, we do business intelligence consulting here in Madison.
I'm Dennis Barnum. I'm here today on behalf of Merlin Mentors. It's a mentoring group, pro bono mentoring group, sponsored by the Research Park, about 6 years old. We basically focus on developing entrepreneurs. So if you are a startup and looking for that kind of help, Field 59 was one of our more stellar graduates. Come and see me.
Good morning, I'm Alex Ryan with Prairie Light Solar. We're a renewable energy advisory firm.
Good morning, I'm Matt Helf, digital marketing consultant.
Seth Braddock, CEO, co-founder of Kilter, personal fitness and wellness platform that rewards you for investing and engaging in your own health.
Derek Kebler with Field 59.
I'm Alex Moe, I'm a reporter for wisbusiness.com.
Travis Heumann, owner of Stray Cat Bicycles.
Carson Lynn, commercial real estate broker with CBRE.
Couldn't hear you.
Sorry? What?
Could you repeat me, sir?
Oh, Gretchen Lynn, I'm a commercial real estate broker with CBRE.
Could you say it faster?
I can't, actually.
Amanda Spegler, I'm doing some independent contracting right now.
Dimitri Sapunas with Tacit, we do identity and identification.
I'm Dan Anderson with Baker Tilly.
Sheldon Thacker with Health Expenditures and Organizer from Motor Jobs.
Well, I think we got everybody in the room, so we are going to turn it over to you now.
Wonderful. Awesome. Well, I appreciate you guys having me. So, my introduction. My name is Kevin O'Rourke, and I am the program manager at NMotion, which is a startup accelerator in Lincoln, Nebraska. So just kind of gauge the room. Does anybody not know what a startup accelerator is? I know you have Generator. That's a pretty prominent name in Madison. So what we do is we run a similar program, but if you were too shy to raise your hand, more or less a startup accelerator is an organization that invests a small amount of money into an early stage company, usually with a tech background. And we get a small portion of equity. We run them through a 90-day program. And each accelerator is a bit different. They have different standards for the companies that they take. They have a different mission for what they want the companies to get out of it. But ultimately, many accelerators have the mission of helping them, the companies they take on, raise a seed round or some sort of financing beyond the program, which is similar to what NMotion does. So I don't know that my talk is going to be quite 15 minutes, but I want to leave plenty of time for questions and answers because I think that's where the most value and interesting sort of engagement is going to come from. But more than anything, today I wanted to chat about what we call at NMotion our roadmap, which is the tool that we use to help founders figure out where they need to focus. So NMotion is in its fifth year of existence. In startup accelerator sort of terms and the life of a startup accelerator, that's pretty good. We were one of the first startup accelerators in the Midwest. So from this sort of date of beginning to where we're at now, we've identified one huge problem that founders consistently run into, and that is not knowing what to focus on. Many first-time founders right out of the gate think the first thing they need to do is raise money, and that's not the case. That's far from it. They shouldn't even be worried about that. They need to be really worried about honing in on their business model, figuring out if they're actually solving a problem, and ultimately just validating that this is a worthwhile venture to pursue. So we've identified five unique stages that most every founder goes through once they try to get to that elusive product market fit. The first sort of phase, and this is kind of the easy one, is the inspiration stage, which is basically asking yourself, do you want to be a founder? Is the startup life right for you? So given the fact that many of you are here at 1MC, the answer is probably yes. But that's still something to think about because whether you know it or not, being a startup founder is lonely and it's kind of a trudge. So maybe just think about that before you start. The next piece of this is the validate stage. So if you want to be an entrepreneur or a founder, there's a good chance that you have a problem or an idea that you are really gung-ho about, you want to pursue it. But the big question is this the venture that you're willing to put 5 to 10 years of your life into to make a reality? So what we kind of direct companies to in early stage founders to are lean methodologies. So talking about things like the business model canvas, the lean canvas, customer discovery, that's really key. So ultimately getting out into the world and talking to the people who you believe have the problem that you're trying to solve. A lot of companies want to just fly through this stage. And I would argue this is probably one of the most important stages in the kind of early life of a startup. If you nail this piece, everything else will fall into place. But if you rush through it and just say, of course, the problem that I'm working on is a big issue and it's going to be a huge company, then you might just waste more time and resources than you had to. The next piece of this is the test phase. And this is where we really dive deep into MVPs and prototyping. So we're talking about ways that we can very quickly and cheaply validate if somebody will pay you to solve the problem that you've identified. So in the previous stage, hopefully you have enough data to say, yes, I have identified that this is a legitimate problem, that people do struggle with this and they're searching for a solution. But now the question is, is the problem big enough that you can actually get somebody to hand over money and say, yes, I'm willing to pay you for this? So we, a lot of times in this sort of phase, direct people to lean practices again, talking about doing mock-ups, landing pages, maybe some sort of digital marketing campaign. The goal here, though, is to really hone in on what is the cheapest and quickest way that you can build this sort of solution or create a solution. It probably won't be scalable, that's totally fine, but just to validate your early adopters to see if they'll actually pay for it. The next phase is the accelerate phase, and this is where NMotion's traditional 90-day accelerator sort of falls. This is the time in a company that probably, this is how it should be, I think, this is where it becomes kind of your full-time gig, or you should start looking at transitioning out of maybe your full-time job or your other lines of work. This is why the accelerator model exists, is to help pull founders out of their job, give them some capital and some security to really go whole haul on their idea. So the question that we're answering, at least at our accelerator, is what is a repeatable business model? So you might have validated that you do have customers who are willing to pay you, but what we want to look at is, what's the business model? Is it scalable? And how are you going to pitch this if you have any intentions on raising a seed round or any follow-on financing? So those are the three big things that we want to cover, at least in our accelerator. And the last phase is the growth stage. And now this is the point where you can probably start to think about building that marvelous product that you had in your mind from the very beginning. This is when you can start investing money in actually creating the full product, maybe writing some code, things like that. But this is also the time when you need to start thinking about, can you get product market fit? You probably wanted to ask that question maybe in that validate stage or even in this inspire stage, but truth be told, you probably weren't even equipped with the knowledge to start thinking about that question until you get to this stage. The other key thing I want to note is that this is not the full life cycle or life of a startup. This is just one, this whole thing is just one phase kind of broken up into five different micro stages. This is our niche at NMotion. This is where we provide support to entrepreneurs, which is why this is the sort of roadmap and framework that we've developed. So, I wish you want to talk a bit more about NMotion as an accelerator. So whether you know it or not, or accelerators are explicit about it or not, they exist on a spectrum. Every accelerator is looking for a specific type of company in a specific industry, maybe in a specific stage. There are some exceptions to this, but it's very key to note that for you as a company, you need to align yourself, if you want to go through an accelerator, with an organization that can really help you connections-wise, that you believe you'll get out of it what you need to get out of it to accomplish your goal, whether that is raise a round or bootstrap it, refine your business model, things like that. So a quick logistics sort of thing for our accelerator. What we're focused on is finding companies who are early stage, they have some sort of a product that, or an MVP I should say, that they can iterate on and have a little bit of revenue. So that could be anywhere between a few hundred dollars to a few thousand dollars, but they need to want to iterate on their business model, so figure out, is this the most efficient way to be actually making money, and then really want to work on that sales funnel, sales process, as well as some of the founder tactics, which are HR, Agile, and ultimately pitching your business. So for us as an organization, our applications close March 14th. So if you know anybody or if you're interested in applying to the accelerator, please reach out. Yeah?
When you're going through this, can you explain what NMotion focuses on? I know it was on the first
definitely
slide, but giving people an idea.
For sure. So we have four verticals, food tech, ag tech, fintech, and then sports and entertainment. Those might seem kind of vague, but the reason why those are verticals, if that question might come up, the short answer is because A, we have mentors who can support companies in those verticals. We've had success in the past in those verticals. And then the other reason is because our investor network is comfortable with those verticals. So a lot of companies' mission is to raise money beyond NMotion. And we believe in those verticals that we have mentors to hook you up with who can actually help you finance. But that's a great question.
Can you repeat those four again, please?
Yes, it is food tech.
Food tech, yeah.
Ag tech. fintech.
Finance.
And yeah, finance, yep. And then sports and entertainment, which we kind of bundle into one, even though it might sound like two. So applications close March 14th. But what we're doing this year kind of differently is we're having a pre-accelerator program. So the sooner you get your application in, what we're doing is we're getting more touch points with companies. We believe that this is gonna result in better investments for us. So if you are interested in applying, I would recommend doing it sooner rather than later. Yes.
How many are you taking in your cohort?
Yes, great question. So we take anywhere between 5 and 8 companies per year. We keep it small. We keep it small so we can provide hands-on. I'll just wait.
All right, we can move for you.
No. Gray minivan.
You will not be shamed if you ask out right.
Never ask complaints, yeah.
So we take anywhere between 5 and 8 companies. This is so we can provide more like that white glove service and really help companies in that cohort and give them as much opportunity as possible to succeed.
And what are some of your successes?
Sure. So one of the big successes that we have from 2 cohorts ago is a company called Quantified Ag. So they're in that ag tech vertical. So they actually came into NMotion with an idea for somehow locating cattle via drones, with drones. Okay. Turned out to not be a very good idea. I couldn't tell you why. I wasn't there at the time, but they ultimately pivoted to helping sort of herd cattle via ear tags. And they've actually went on to raise, they raised, I think, 500,000 seed round, and then they went on to raise another 2.3 million in a Series A. I think now they've, yep.
And they did the pivot in your cohort?
Yep, they did the pivot in the cohort, which is one of the things that we try to focus on. It comes back to that business model, and it may not be a drastic change to the business as a whole. So a pivot may not be quite the right word. It might be just a slight course
correction. No, I understand. Yeah.
We want to make sure that they're setting themselves up for success and failing while they're in the cohort so they still have the support to actually move on.
I'm sorry, I dominated questions, but I got, you know, we would probably, you know, potentially, you know, mm-hmm. recommend people here. So the one question I have is that your areas, although very specific, are not unique.
Yep.
To these types of things, the accelerators. What is it about you that you feel sets you apart in those specific areas where you say somebody else also does ag tech?
Mm-hmm. So I would say that, I mean, there's going to be competition regardless. What I believe is that our mentor network is extremely strong in those verticals. And then our past companies that have been in those verticals, because we do take companies outside of those, just to be clear.
Sure.
Those are our specialties, but if there's a very strong company who exists outside of those, we will take them in. But the companies within those verticals have A, now become mentors to new cohorts, or will become mentors to new cohorts, and we've seen success in raising money, so that's what we can point to.
Does your angel money that come from local, or is it more regional?
Great question. So currently we have a very strong local base, but what we're extremely excited about is this year we're going to take a very strong sort of initiative in bringing in outside investors. So phase one of this is contacting investors from either of the coasts or maybe some pockets of startup hubs that or tech hubs that aren't maybe conventional, and flying them in. So really just rolling out the red carpet for these people and introducing them to all of our cohort companies so they can get exposure.
And is there pressure to relocate to Nebraska?
Just for the 3 months. I mean, obviously we would love all of our companies right. to stay in Lincoln for economic growth and just being part of our...
I mean, from your investors?
Yes and no. We do have companies who've been through the cohort who were not from Lincoln or even a surrounding area who've been from the coast even, and they are more than welcome to move out there. Again, I think it's preferred that they do, but sure. it's not a necessity.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry, I think we're asking a lot of questions. You actually didn't finish one of the core questions that I think a lot of people here care about is the success. You said the company had gone on to raise mm-hmm. 2.5 in an A.
Yep.
And
And now where is it at?
Yeah, current valuation is, I think they're somewhere at like 12 million now.
And then do you have others? Because I think that's, you know, a lot of entrepreneurs obviously care about how many come through your program and actually end up getting funded. That's probably the biggest and most important thing.
Yep.
And then I would, you should definitely finish, because usually,
no, I understand. It's cool that this is informal, though. Like, I'm running and gunning with questions on the fly. That's fine.
So that would be a question. I think a lot of companies care to understand is, you know, how many actually get funded through your program. So you've now had five years, you said?
Yes.
And you're averaging what run on costs per cohort.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm assuming you have 30, 40, 50 companies out of here. So what's kind of your
right. So this will be our fifth year, so we've taken on four cohorts, and that equates to, I think, about 24, 25 companies.
26
on
your website.
26? Perfect. No, fact checking me, I like it.
Listen, I want to see who these companies are, I love it.
Yeah. So we've had, I believe, a little under half of them, so right around that 40% mark, that have raised money beyond NMotion, and then ones that I would consider are just like crushing it and killing it right now, we're at about eight of those. The key thing to note is our accelerator has evolved since its sort of conception date. We were taking ideas that are kind of back of the napkin to start out with, which might be what a lot of accelerators were doing when they first started. We refined our model, and the success has shown from probably the last couple of years where we've really iterated and started to hone in. But great question. Yes.
So obviously I took a look.
Yeah.
I don't see companies that appear to be fintech, but you're looking for those type of companies.
Right.
What's the deal?
Two parts. Our board of directors really wants to start focusing on fintech, since we do have a very strong network of fintech companies, not necessarily who went through our NMotion program.
Not just the money.
In the area, what was that?
The people with the money.
Oh yeah, for sure, and they're the people with the money. They want to invest in that too. But we do have one success called Hip Money,
okay,
who actually presented at South by Southwest as one of the top five fastest growing fintech companies, who went through our cohort. So he has a ton of connections, and in conjunction with the investor money, that's a big push to fintech.
Okay.
So, great question though. Yeah. Cool.
Yeah, do you have more of your presentation?
We're about done. So,
but hijacked it.
Yeah, no, these are all great questions. So, cohort runs from May 8th to August 10th. One of the kind of prerequisites to actually being a part of it is that you relocate to Lincoln for the 3 months. But after that, you are free to go wherever. We'd love for you to stay, but you are not required to. And then financing-wise, and the funding works out to be about $20,000 for 6%. That is in a form of a convertible note. It doesn't trigger until you have raised about $250,000. And the numbers get kind of weird after that, because we're diluted. So if you raise more, we might not get 6%. It's not just a flat 6. But if you're curious about that, we can talk about it later. Yeah, so I think that's more or less my presentation. Yep.
On that convertible loan, is it capped?
No, it's not.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when you talk about your model, I mean, one of the interesting things that's come out, so startup, there's one out of Baltimore,
one accelerator, Dream It, and I think it's Dream It, and they just scrapped their accelerator model. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of accelerators are having a hard time showing. So what, you know, part of the concern, obviously, is you go through an accelerator, and if you go through 500 startups, you go through Y Combinator, those classes are just, I mean, there's so many names, right? The benefit of that's not even the accelerator anymore, it's just the graduates, right? So what happens to you, because Dream It's under that same thing, where they just scrapped their accelerator, and they're now basically taking on later stage companies, because they're like, we can't make it work. The 6%, all that's great, but these companies, like you said, you have a hit rate of 40% kind of right now.
Yep.
So what's gonna keep you from potentially making sure that doesn't occur to you, and some company that goes through it today, tomorrow doesn't really have an NMotion network anymore because they've changed their plan.
Right, so I was having a conversation about that yesterday and even briefly this morning. That's a great question. I think what's very important for people who run accelerators, for investors, for communities as a whole, is to look at accelerators with skepticism. So there have been cases, even in Lincoln, where the accelerator model hasn't worked. one of our competing accelerators in Omaha has kind of went under. They've changed their model. They're still in existence. They've kind of reformed as something else. I'm not sure if that'll work, but I'm eager to see if it will. But the one thing that I think is crucial, at least here in the Midwest, is to build bridges between communities, which is another big reason for why I'm here. I'm here to recruit startups who we may overlook if we don't get out of our own little bubble. Not to poach by any means, because there's some great programs here in Madison, but the reality of it is there's going to be a surplus of companies who want to get into an accelerator. And as I said before, you may not be right for one accelerator, but you might be right for us. So we want to make sure that A, we're giving as many opportunities to founders, and B, that we're doing our due diligence and making sure that we're getting the best companies. So that's the big reason for the roadshow and why I'm here. And I think that's going to be something that maybe sets us apart, but that eye of skepticism will also be key going forward to see how we can make it better.
And are most of your investors that come in post-accelerator angels? If you have VCs that are, like local VCs that are,
A combination of both, but actually a lot of it is VC money. So yeah, we do have some good connections, and I'm from Iowa originally. Even though Nebraska is just a short 3 hours or so west, it seems that raising money in Nebraska is at least a little bit easier than it is in Iowa, because I went, you know, tried to go down that fundraising path, and maybe I wasn't good at it, but it was extremely difficult, where it seems like some of the companies in Lincoln have a bit of an easier time, which is really strong for their community, so that's good. Yeah, Rachel.
Can you share a little bit more of your personal background and kind of how you came to be at NMotion, and what makes you qualified?
Sure.
And then you can give a shout out to your ties to 1MC too.
Oh, definitely, yeah. So,
what's your name again?
Kevin.
Did you spell it?
It's K-E-E-V-I-N. So like Kevin, but with two E's.
Oh, I get you, okay.
Yeah. For sure. So I was born in Iowa, went to college at the University of Northern Iowa, where I studied marketing. I was an accounting major for like 3 years, but I realized that was crap and I wasn't really built for that life. So went to marketing, but a big part of my college career was getting into entrepreneurship. So I've been a startup weekend. You guys do startup weekends in Madison?
Mm-hmm.
You do? Okay, cool. So I've been a startup weekend facilitator for the last 3 years. Which is really what got me sort of exposed to a bunch of different communities. I've had the opportunity to kind of fly around and at least meet some local founders and community leaders, which also got me tied into 1 Million Cups in my local community. So after graduation, I started a startup. I'd started a few before those, but those all were colossal failures, so we won't talk about those. Started a company after college, and then I had the opportunity to go through a startup accelerator, not NMotion, and worked through the company for a while post-accelerator. Unfortunately, that company did not work out either, but I felt like I learned the most from that one. Definitely saw some things that we as a team did wrong, but also the marketing and or the market wasn't quite right for it either. So one of the things that makes me uniquely qualified to be part of NMotion now, which is why I moved to Lincoln, is that I've been through a startup accelerator. Our managing director has also been through a startup accelerator as a company. So we've sat at the other side of the table. I definitely have some unique ideas and perspectives on what I didn't like about what the accelerator experience was like for me. So I want to take an active role in making sure that we're actually benefiting founders and doing everything that's possible to make them a success. So that's kind of the nutshell pitch.
So can I ask, this isn't an NMotion question, but
sure.
How does this Million Cups compare to what you have going on there?
For sure. So this is very similar, actually. So in Lincoln, we usually do two presenters, actually. So that's kind of interesting. We give them 6 minutes each rather than 12. But I can't speak to whether that's going to be more or less successful. But in my home community, we didn't do 1 Million Cups every week. I'm not sure you guys do it every week, though, every Wednesday. Yeah, we don't have the number of companies to support doing it every week. So I think we were doing it, we started out bi-weekly, and then we moved even to like once a month. But Cedar Falls is where I'm talking about right now. They only have like 40,000 people who live there. So much smaller population, but in terms of sort of layout and the way things are going, it seems to be incredibly similar to at least Lincoln.
Yeah. As far as the funding goes, anybody that goes through this, are they required to sign up for that? I mean, at some point, are they required to pass along 6% of the company and accept funding, or can they say, I don't want any of the funding and we're not going to give up any equity?
Yes, you are. So you get $20,000 just straight out. We actually don't require our companies to register as a C Corp in Delaware, which is another kind of unique thing about our accelerator because it's expensive. And if they want to raise follow-on funding, they do that. But at least at first, it seems maybe unnecessary if they aren't going to actually go on. But to answer your question, yes, that is a requirement. But like I said, it doesn't actually trigger until you raise additional capital. But if you don't do that, typically you're not going to succeed. So okay. You could bootstrap it. And then if you get acquired, though, there's some rules in there, too. So in the end, if things go well, we end up taking a percentage.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Can you talk more about what your vetting process is, other than the things you've already mentioned?
Sure. So right now, so we talked about the pre-accelerator. I can dive a bit more into that. Investing in early stage startups is risky, probably regardless of how much due diligence you do, just because there's so many unknowns. And just by the sheer nature of a startup, you're just talking about a set of assumptions. So one of the things that we want to do in the pre-accelerator is get as many touch points as possible. So that means we're actually going to hop on the phone with you, talk with you. We have these forms for you to fill out. They're really short, not intense, but just to give us a snapshot of how your company is progressing throughout the weeks, so we can just collect data on it. Prior to that, so even before that, on who are we looking for to even apply, we're looking for companies who have some sort of an MVP built. So something that they can test, even in, when I say built, that could be you working off of Excel spreadsheets and pulling levers in the background. Like, we don't need you to have a physical product. We need you to be able to actually acquire a customer and be able to do something with them, whether that's a tech thing that you end up implementing or it's just manual labor for right now until you can figure out or build a more scalable thing. So that's one piece. And the second piece is, we want you to be able to have those customers so you can test business models, test your sales funnel and your marketing, and actually start working through some of the key financial projections that you're going to need to know if you want to go on and raise money. Was that helpful? Okay.
And I think we're about at time, so we're going to wrap things up. Mm-hmm. Let's give Kevin a big round of applause. Sticking around for a few minutes if people want to come chat with you individually.
Yep,
and
for sure.
Maybe get your contact information. I'm sure that they can, if they're interested, they can go to your website and apply.
Yep. So one other key thing. So I'm going to be at 100 State today doing office hours. I've got a few spots still open, but I'll be there from like 10:30 to 5. So if you're interested, like, just please reach out or just come talk to me. I can give you like the link or we can set something up. I'm very much so interested in meeting as many companies as possible. So if you're on the fence about it, just let's do it. Let's just have a conversation about it. So, yeah. Awesome.
Eat the donuts.
And eat the donuts. I do not want to take all of those with me. So please.
Although they'll get eaten up at 100
States. Yeah, take them 100
States. That's true. Yeah. Just
don't go over there.
Bring them over there. Awesome. Well, thank you again.
Yes. Thank you, guys.